Good morning and welcome, and thank you for joining with us this morning as we come together to celebrate the service of the Word on this, the sixth Sunday after Trinity. Please do join in with the responses in bold as they appear on your screen, and thanks to Reverend Daniel for doing all of the hard work and putting everything together. We're meeting at home today, but we are moving a little bit closer in meeting in the church building. And we did stream worship from there last Sunday. It was a little bit odd, nobody there. But I do want to encourage you that when worship does begin in the building at St Clair's in August, please do come along if you're not shielding and if you're in good health. We do realise that there is a sense of great joy to be able to meet physically together once again, but also some people might be a little bit nervous and anxious about that. Please don't be, but we do know what it's like. We will put every measure in place to make sure that everybody is kept as safe as possible, and these measures will be reviewed regularly. St Clair's building, it will happen in St Clair's Church first of all, but it is a parish church and it's in the middle of the town centre. And really that means that that church is open for everybody, so please do come along. But please do keep connected too with our online worship. Those working difficult shift patterns, or maybe have young children at home, or maybe are a little bit under the weather and can't come along on that particular Sunday morning. We know that you are watching these services, dipping into them as and when you can, and that needs to continue too. So please, please do keep on being connected with us. There might not be so much of an abundance of these services, but we hope that they will continue. So welcome. As children of God, chosen, beloved, accepted and forgiven, welcome. Words that I hope you can reflect on in our opening song, Who You Say I Am.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but He brought me in. Oh, His love for me. Oh, His love for me. Who the sun sets free. Oh, is free. A slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, He died.
Place for
Now let's just pause in the quiet and bring ourselves before God. We come from scattered lives to meet with God. Let us recognise his presence with us. As God's people we have gathered, let us worship him together. And now we have our collect on this, the sixth Sunday after Trinity. So let us pray. Creator God, you made us all in your image. May we discern you in all that we see and serve you in all that we do. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Now we have a time where we come before God to say sorry for those things, spoken or unspoken, that we know have not pleased us or God. He is listening and he has a heart to forgive all his children. We come to God as one from whom no secrets are hidden, to ask for his forgiveness and peace. God our Father, we are sorry for the times where we have used your gifts carelessly and acted ungratefully. Hear our prayer and in your mercy, forgive us and help us. We enjoy the fruits of the harvest, but sometimes forget that you have given them to us. Father, in your mercy, forgive us and help us. We belong to a people who are full and satisfied, but ignore the cry of the hungry. Father, in your mercy, forgive us and help us. We are thoughtless and do not care enough for the world you have made. Father, in your mercy, forgive us and help us. We store up goods for ourselves alone, as if there were no God and no heaven. Father, in your mercy, forgive us and help us. Almighty God, who in Jesus Christ has given us a kingdom that cannot be destroyed, forgive us our sins, open our eyes to God's truth, and strengthen us to do God's will, and give us the joy of his kingdom. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. In confessing our sins before God, we can now join together to praise his name using the words of the Gloria. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. It's now time for our gospel passage, and this is read to us this morning by Imogen Clarkson, a member of our parish youth. That will be followed by the sermon from Reverend Anne.
The Gospel reading today is from Mark 6. The apostles returned to Jesus and told him all that they had done and taught. He said to them, "Come away by yourselves to a lonely place and rest a while." For many were coming and going, and they had no leisure even to eat. And they went away in the boat to a lonely place by themselves. Now many saw them going and knew them, and they ran there on foot from all the towns and got there ahead of them. As he went ashore, he saw a great throng, and he had compassion on them, because they were like sheep without a shepherd, and he began to teach them many things. And when they had crossed over, they came to a land at Gennesaret, and moored to the shore. And when they got out of the boat, immediately the people recognised him, and ran about the whole neighbourhood, and began to bring sick people on their pallets to any place where they heard he was. And wherever he came, in villages, cities or country, they laid the sick in the marketplaces and besought him that they might touch even the fringe of his garment. And as many as touch, it was made well. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
I was working on something at my desk the other day and my mind was wandering, so I thought I'd best take a break. And that's what they say, you should have a break and then go back to it afresh. And I noticed a quiz on Facebook that tempted me a little bit because I thought I could make a good stab at it. And it was about recognising famous people. Well, the first photograph came up and it was Elon Musk, who I don't really know very much about, I must admit, but I know he's Elon Musk. I recognised his face. The second one, and it felt good. The second one was really easy. It was Mark Zuckerberg of fame from Facebook. And the third one, Vladimir Putin. And I just thought, oh, come on, they're having a laugh here. They're making it far too easy. But I moved on, and at last a challenge. I had no idea who it was. I did not recognise the person. However, they gave you an alternative. It was either, who was it, Ted Turner or Rupert Murdoch, and I knew it wasn't Rupert Murdoch, so therefore it was Ted Turner, and I was just cross because they made it far too easy. I realised I possibly could have guessed my way through the entire thing and done very well, but actually it was more about guessing, and I didn't really know the people, I just recognised who they were. Made me wonder whether or not that's a bit like some of us with Jesus. We recognise him from all kinds of things, from statues, pictures, Jesus of Nazareth, do you remember? Robert Powell as Jesus of Nazareth, or reading the Bible. But do we really recognise deeply who he truly is? And Mark's Gospel is a really good place to start. The word euthos in the Greek is used, I think it's 40 times in Mark, and that means immediately. Immediately this happened and immediately that happened. And it lurches from one action to another. The storm is stilled, the Gerasene demoniac is freed, the dead girl is brought to life, the woman sick for many years is healed. He has power over every element. He's drawn his disciples to him and then he sends them out to go and spread the good news. Yes, we recognise Jesus in all of this. We recognise him. There's teaching and parables galore in today's reading. I think there's something else. They've come together following the 12 being sent out and they need to rest and regroup and catch up. So they get away, well, at least they intend to get away. But the crowds recognise Jesus, and like iron filings to a magnet, they cling to him. They go and they find him. And that is despite the fact that Jesus has got into a boat and taken his friends to a deserted place. They are met by the crowd. Is he cross? Is he exasperated? No. His heart goes out to them, for they were like a sheep without a shepherd. So we recognise Jesus, but do we truly know him in this response? For he is that shepherd that's spoken of in Ezekiel chapter 34. And it says this, "Mortal, prophesy against the shepherds of Israel. Prophesy and say to them, to the shepherds, thus says the Lord God, are you shepherds of Israel who've been feeding yourselves? Should not shepherds feed the sheep? You eat the fat, you clothe yourselves with the wool, you slaughter the fatlings, but you do not feed the sheep. You have not strengthened the weak. You have not healed the sick. You have not bound up the injured. You have not brought back the strayed. You have not sought the lost. But with force and harshness, you have ruled them. So they were scattered because there was no shepherd, and scattered they became food for all the wild animals." Wow. In Jesus, God gave Israel that shepherd that they needed, the shepherd he intended for Israel from the beginning, but the shepherd that he is according to his nature. Now, the horrific events of Herod beheading John the Baptist, the actual herald of God's reign, that is there in this gospel. And Euthus immediately, it's read in the context of salvation, the saving plan of God. And of course, shepherds feed the sheep, and he does, 5,000 plus, in a passage that our text skips over. And in that feeding, it's sometimes known as the Galilean Lord's Supper. Think on that. Recognise Jesus and something else. Jesus told many stories of God feeding his chosen people at a banquet in the context of his reign, the banquet in heaven, the banquet of a king, and here he is feeding the lonely, the sick, the lost sheep, feeding them bread and fish, but most significantly, feeding them his words. Has our recognised moved on to something else yet? Does our doubt get in the way? Our passage jumps over the account of Jesus walking on water. But I invite you to let your faith seek understanding as we continue to the end of this exploration. Jesus says to the woman recorded earlier in Mark, "Your faith has healed you." There's something in our passage that tells us that faith allows our recognising to turn into realising. I read this story of a friend who got to go to a test screening of the film Pulp Fiction years ago. When she came out, she saw Jimmy outside asking people what they thought. She recognised him from the scene he was in and proceeded to tell him that even though he only had a very, very small part, he'd done well. He had talent. He should stick at it, and someday he might make it big. He was really nice to her and thanked her for her kind words. Someone came up to him seconds later telling him that it was the best movie he'd ever written and directed. That's when she realised she'd just met Quentin Tarantino, one of the most accomplished writers and directors in the movie world. Jesus isn't just someone in history like Julius Caesar. He isn't just someone who could do a few party tricks. He's the shepherd of Ezekiel who feeds the sheep. He's the bread of life. And yes, he's here, yes, to heal, but not particularly the withered hands or the lepers, though he did. But he's here to heal the relationship between God and his people, to reset the basis of life itself, to initiate and establish the kingdom of God. And as our reading continues, Jesus and his friends have moved on once again and been followed once again by those who are seeking healing. And this time they are in a place called the Agora, the marketplace, where legal hearings would have taken place. Debates, buying and selling. It was the place of politics and commerce, areas of life dominated by the rich and the powerful. Here Jesus responds with love, as yet again people rush about bringing the sick to him, even to touch the hem of his garment, because then they are healed. Not the rich, not the famous, not the powerful, not the holy. Possibly some of the poorest, the scabbiest, those with little hope, that's who came to him and were healed. For God's kingdom was coming to subvert all the world's power and values and initiate kingdom values where all are valued and all are loved and all are equal. Not because of money, not because of material things, not because of status, but by virtue of being a child of God. Jesus embodied that most wonderful gift, grace. So I invite you today to recognise Jesus and receive his grace, to recognise Jesus and realise that undeserved favour that rests upon us all, if we would just receive it. He is your shepherd. He is your saviour. He didn't come to condemn, but to be the one perfect, sufficient sacrifice for our sins. For there is no more judgment. He fulfilled the law. Now there is only grace to be accepted. There is only judgment in that we reject that grace, reject that forgiveness. Now there is only grace, and I invite you to recognise Jesus afresh and realise his grace. In Brennan Manning's book, The Ragamuffin Gospel, he quotes from another book, The Moviegoer, in which a commuter who'd ridden a train countless times, desperately unhappy, is filled with despair. On a particular day, he suffers a heart attack at one of the stations he's passed through countless times, but this time he is removed from the train. He's taken to hospital, and he wakes up and he quickly realises that this event has opened his eyes to the wonder of life and the gift of it all. Manning says of the story, the commuter grabs his own existence around the neck and begins to live a renewed life in an ordinary world that had not been cleansed of its everydayness. Our gracious God issues a call to choose between generativity and stagnation, between continuing to have an impact or sitting around waiting to die. And I think the difference is grabbing hold of that gift of grace, the knowledge that you are forgiven, the knowledge that you are saved forever and a day. You are a child of God and everything is a gift. So I invite you to recognise Jesus, realise his favour upon you, his grace. And as he continues to build his kingdom, initiated through the offering of his life, offer him your life, through which a little bit of that kingdom may come. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love. We thank you that you journey with us and that you long for us to open our eyes and not just recognise you, Jesus, for who you are, but realise what you have done for each one of us, for the gift that you give to us. And Lord, help us to receive that gift and let it show in the life we live amongst those who may or may not know you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
So just before we enter into affirming our faith and receiving our prayers, we have a song to refresh and restore us that speaks of trusting in God alone. The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want.
The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me lie in pastures green. He leads me by the still, still waters. His goodness restores my soul. And I will trust in you, and I will trust in you alone, for your endless mercy follows me, your goodness will my ways in righteousness, and he anoints my head with oil, and my cup it overflows with joy. I feast on his
together to declare our faith in God. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith, fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Our prayers of intercession this morning are brought to us by Elizabeth Brown.
Many of us have been forced into a quiet place during the COVID crisis. We can find God in the stillness and quiet. There is power in private prayer and no constraints in the where, the how, and the when. We bring before God our prayers for others today. Let's think of our prayers being like circles in the pond, causing ripples on the water. The surface is still and silent, and as the pebble drops, the circles spread out wider. So just as our prayers come from ourselves, our hope is that our prayers reach out to others. What lies heavy on your heart today? Drop your prayer into the water and seek God. People closest to us, family and friends, we know their strengths and their struggles. We pray for them now. In the next circle are people we know well but don't see as often as we'd like. Those we remember with gratitude and joy, who shaped our lives. We think of them now. May they know God's blessing. As the circle spreads out wider, we think about those in our town and community, those we live and work alongside. Their faces may be familiar, but we don't know their name. Those who work in shops who serve us well. Those who work in industry supplying our needs. Those who care for others in need. Who deliver the mail and empty the bins. Bless our parish and its people. Let them be washed by these ripples of prayer. Our circle spreads wider as we ask for your healing on those who are sick in body, mind, or spirit. For those for whom this day will be their last. Gather into your arms those who have died recently and those whose memorial fall at this time. The circles now spread out until they reach the edge of the bank. And our prayers extend to the end of the earth. Our troubled world, crying out for justice, peace, fairness, and healing. See the ripples of prayer. Touch and bless this world. Circles of God's love to embrace and reach out to comfort, to challenge and sustain. Living God, our prayer this morning is a tiny pebble thrown into a huge expanse of need. We thank you that your love is greater still, and we entrust every circle of prayer to your generous mercy and grace. We ask our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ and in the power of the Spirit. Amen. Now let's gather our prayers, spoken and unspoken, together as we commit ourselves to God's way, God's kingdom, and share the Lord's Prayer together.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
So our prayers tell us that we create positive ripples into this world Every time you offer a kind word or a loving action or a smile, because whoever receives it then passes it on to someone, who then passes it on, who then passes it on, who then passes it on. So just before we have our closing prayers today, it just falls for me to say thank you once again for joining me, and I hope you've enjoyed and got something from this service. St Clair's will be open for private prayer today from 11 o'clock till 1. It would be lovely to see some of you there. And also there will be our evening Eucharist, which will be on this page a bit later too. So let's just close in prayer. God of our pilgrimage, you have led us to the living water. Refresh and sustain us as we go forward on our journey. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. You are called and loved by God the Father and kept safe by Jesus Christ. Mercy, peace and love be yours in abundance from God the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. Our final hymn today is the wonderful Amazing Grace.
Unending love, dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. Will be forever.